McCoy. I am the director of theater here at Topeka West High School. I know most of you. If I haven't seen you, you should come see some shows. Our next show is going to be the library in April, April 14, 15, 16. You won't want to miss it. People will be talking about it. I guarantee it. That being said, what you're here today to see is our Acting 2 class and their presentation for Heritage Week. We've been working on it the last few weeks. So without any further ado, here's the Acting 2 class.
See McCoy standing in front of the classroom. I was hoping for it to be an easy class, but then all of a sudden, he starts talking about our huge Cuban heritage performance. I heard this, and the first thing that popped in my head was I really need to change my schedule.
I heard McCoy say this and was really hesitant about the whole situation because it was going to be so much more work than I'd hoped for.
At first, when he was talking, I spaced out, but then I came back to reality. The whole time I was actually listening, I was like, I can't even. And then he just kept talking even more, and finally, I couldn't even deal. Like, I just can't. I can't even begin to imagine what's going through a small brain of this.
I have no problem with this project, like everyone else does, but I do, however, have a problem with it. I mean, I'm glad we have this project for him to talk about, so he can finally shut up about his dog, Juno Hawkins' dog, and his wife/girlfriend. And let's just take a moment to notice how his boys are. I mean, come on, McCoy, we're in Kansas, not Scotland.
Move it along.
Got you, McCoy. Check it out. Okay. I even made some visuals. All right. Who wants to learn some ish about Cuba? Yeah. Okay.
Come on. Who wants to learn about Cuba? Yay. Be a C.
No.
Be a U.
No.
Be a V.
No.
Wait.
Walk is.
Walk.
Walk. Great. Now, where did walk originate?
Avocados.
No. Mexico. All right. Walk is from Mexico. And what language do they speak in Mexico?
Spanish.
Spanish.
Lucky them.
And that is why they speak Spanish.
People speak Spanish because of Spanish from Spain. Conquered it in the 1500s, and then fought wars to hold on to it until finally losing it to the U.S. in 1898.
Nerd.
She's right, though. Remember the main big ship exploded mysteriously in Havana? We blamed the Spanish and keep their butt in here? Any of this ringing a bell?
Yeah, ooh, of course.
Anything else, guys? That's it? That's all we got?
Oh, no.
Seriously? Kaylee.
Cuba's shaped like a crocodile from the air.
The Republic of Cuba encompasses over 4,000 islands. The mainland has a population of 11,275,000.
Cuba has a 99.8% literacy rate, which is the highest in the world.
When Fidel Castro was put in power, he banned all Monopoly games.
Dance is very important in Cuba.
Castro banned the Beatles.
And he also made a statue of John Lennon. There's a rare prehistoric fish called the mangar now only found in Cuba.
Fidel Castro was born on a Friday the 13th.
Castro started growing in a beard because the U.S. cut off his supply of razors.
It's known once in Cuba, March 12, 1857.
You can't just read stuff off your phones. What else do you have? You've got to have something better.
Today, the United States of America is changing its relationship with people of Cuba. And the most significant changes in our policy in more than 50 years. We will end an outdated approach that for decades has failed to advance our interests. And instead, we will begin to normalize relations between our two countries. Through these changes, we begin a new chapter among the nations of the Americas. In politics, business, culture, and sports, like immigrants before, Cubans help remake America even as they felt a painful yearning for the land and families they left behind. All of this bound America and Cuba in a unique relationship, at once, family and foe.
Wow.
Yeah. Did you just make that up?
No, Obama's speech writer.
That's the story, though.
You heard it. We're beginning a new chapter. The Cuban exile community in the U.S. America and Cuba. At once, family and foe.
I don't get it.
Stories of exiles.
The stories of those who immigrated to the U.S.
Like all the good baseball players.
Yes, authors, musicians, and everyday folk who left their homeland in hopes for a better life for themselves and their families.
But really just the good baseball players, right? Which color do you want? This is the question that changed my life.
No, Cameron, you can't just keep making stuff up again.
I'm not. This is a real story of an exile.
Uh-huh. Right. Sorry about that. It gets a little excited. Let's start here. Margarita Engel, 1951.
The first time my parents take me soaring through the magical sky in Cuba, I am so little I can hardly speak to my island relatives. My abuelita, my old grandma, who still loves to dance, and her ancient mama, my great-grandma, who still loves to garden, working just as hard as any strong young man. Already, this island is beginning to seem like a fairy tale kingdom, where ordinary people do impossible things. Everywhere we go, I hear cave songbirds and wild parrots. I fall in love with the farm where my abuelita and her ancient mother were born. But each time we fly back to our everyday lives in California, one of my two selves is left behind. The girl I would be if we lived on Mommy's island instead of Dad's continent.
Sometimes I feel like a rolling wave of the sea.
A wave that can only belong between the two solid shores.
Sometimes I feel like a bridge. Or a storm.
Two countries, two families, two sets of words.
Am I free to need both? Or will I always have to choose only one way of thinking?
8 years later, 1959, at home in California.
I'm beginning to expect that the expense of the airplane tickets was not my parents' only reason for running around Mexico all summer, earthbound, instead of flying through the enchanted air to Cuba.
Revolution!
Violence!
Gunfire! Danger!
The old black and white TV flickers, as if it has a conscience and is reluctant to keep showing one horror after another.
People in Cuba are fighting. It's a civil war to overthrow a dictator.
Are your cousins killing others?
Watch Cuba, the revolutionary Che Guevara.
From the first, she threw herself into revolutionary work enthusiastically and with exemplary devotion.
I watched as Guillermo Galen, one of our best fighters, fought bravely.
This is Lydia, 45 years old, and a baker.
I saw them advancing towards us. I went to pull out my small 32 revolver to give off some warning shots.
You shoot those warning rounds, we will die.
I watched as he fought bravely.
He knew what would have happened if he fell into the hands of those thugs.
He committed suicide. Me they would have killed, but the boy they would have saved. Me, I'm already an old woman. The boy wasn't even 20.
Later, Lydia disappeared. Maybe someday her remains will be found on some lonely field on the enormous cemetery of the island.
Even with their losses, the revolution was successful.
Fidel Castro was the new leader of Cuba. Fearing that we'd be enslaved, our parents sent us away, so many of us, to a land across the turquoise sea. Alone.
All alone.
No mom, no dad, no kin on the alien shore. Our exes image known as Pedro Pan.
Operation Peter Pan in English.
A ridiculous name for something so unlike a fairy tale. We lost our childhood in a blinding flash.
Forever.
Between 1960 and 1962.
14,000 of us.
Exile. Orphan.
For what?
Freedom.
Operation Peter Pan.
A ridiculous name for something so unlike a fairy tale.
For us who flew away, for our families left behind, and our captive brethren, freedom is no abstraction. It's as real as the marrow in our bones.
Or the words I speak.
Or whatever you ate today.
As crucial as breathing. Our would-be overlords, Castro and Che, marvel too. As they choke on their bile, it irks them to know that we escaped. And they so envy our luminous stars and ceaseless resurrection.
Operation Peter Pan was first developed by Father Brian O'Mops, director of the Catholic Welfare Bureau.
I was inspired by a 15-year-old Cuban boy named Pedro Menendez who immigrated to Miami. His relatives could not support him, so they came to us at the Catholic Welfare Bureau for help.
Rumor had it that Fidel Castro was sending children to the Soviet Union to serve in work camps.
Cuban parents feared for their children. We knew that soon more Pedros would be immigrating to the United States, a better option than going to the USSR. The CIA agreed.
The CIA wanted the citizens of Cuba to doubt their new leader, Fidel Castro, and his decisions.
Thus, we spearheaded one of the world's largest political exoduses of children in history, Operation Pedro Pan.
Between 1960 and 1962, 14,000 children were sent away by desperate parents who feared for their children's future under Castro.
Unlike Peter Pan, however, these children continued to grow up, even while separated from their families.
This is one of those stories. Carlos Air.
The sprinklers woke me up. A sound I'd never heard before. I jumped out of bed and ran to the nearest window. What I saw floored me. It was a flat landscape, flatter than I had ever seen before. I had no idea the earth could be so featureless, so much of a pancake. All I could hear was... I'd seen small sprinklers, of course, but none as huge as these. Fountains. Americans are so advanced and so wealthy that they can dot the landscape with them, just for the hell of it. Simply because they look cool. Or maybe they were a secret weapon spraying lethal acid to keep the Russians away.
At school, all the teachers and students seemed angered by Cuba.
What are you?
It's a question that requires fractions. And I don't like math. Do I have to admit that I'm Cuban, or am I American? All the fractions left behind by immigration from a country 90 miles off the coast?
We were like Santa Claus on that poor little island.
She speaks directly into my ear as we're confiding some terrible secret.
Such ingratitude.
Clearly, it's an accusation. Even though I don't understand, somehow I end up feeling guilty. Why should I let some ingrate grown-up imagine that she knows me?
Suddenly, I realized I was now an orphan. At least for the time being. Suddenly, I no longer saw her in the sprinklers. Instead, I felt alone in a dark void, crushed by a great force from all sides, and to be painfully aware of one's eternal loneliness. This is hell, at least my hell. The one I entered that morning, hell is having no one to love and no one to love you back. Hell's an eternal, unfulfillable longing.
April, 1961, Bay of Pigs.
A swampy invasion.
It's all over the news.
An attack by CIA trained Cuban exiles armed with weapons from the U.S.
They're soon defeated.
The vast United States loses, and tiny Cuba wins, and now
both governments are even angrier than before.
I do remember what broke the evil spell, however. It was a surprise call from my parents in Havana. I still have no idea if that call was arranged. Phone connections between Cuba and the United States have been limited by the Cuban government.
Hola, hijo. ¿Cómo has estado? ¿Estás comiendo?
Sí, mamá. Estoy comiendo. Estoy seguro que estoy bien.
Te extrañamos.
Igualmente.
Bueno.
Hola, pa.
¿Ya comiste?
Sí.
¿Estás seguro?
Claro.
Bien. Te amo.
Those 3 minutes remind me of the fact that I had not died and gone to some afterlife, but was just alone and left the people I loved behind. I wanted to stand. I wanted to fit in, not stand out anyway.
I was hell-bound becoming an American. I didn't speak much English, but I knew what the English version of my name should be. And when my new foster parents asked me what I'd like to be called, I said, Charles. That was my first successful attempt at becoming someone other than myself. My blonde hair and fair skin fooled most Americans as well.
Charles ain't Cuban.
Yes, he is. I saw the teacher's attendance. His name is Carlos.
But Cubans all have dark hair, skin, and eyes.
Maybe he's a freak, but he's Cuban.
We weren't supposed to be smart, either.
Hey, you know Spanish?
Si. How do you say?
Everyone wants me to teach them bad words in Spanish.
I cannot add to how many times I've heard that request already. But if I don't, I'd be totally uncool. Worse than a nerd. What's a kid to do?
Remolacha.
Remolada?
Yeah.
What does remolacha mean anyway?
It means sex. You know the really dirty word with the F?
Awesome. Yeah, thanks, Charles.
Little do they know, I just taught them how to say beet, like a vegetable. Since everyone knows I'm Cuban, they believe everything I teach them in Spanish. However, in English, everyone makes fun of me when I try to pronounce a word.
Carlos, I mean Charles. Antonyms or opposites, if something isn't hard, it is
easy.
States, we say EZ. Now you try.
EC.
Even then, my goal was to lose whatever accent I had left.
Living with an American family made it easy for travelers to forget about Carlos.
It's been flash forward years later. It's 1865, Chicago Station.
It's been 1,307 days I've been apart from my mother.
Te ves tan viejita.
Te ves tan grande y guapo. I want to imagine a better future so I can enjoy this long-delayed reunion.
If only we could see into the future.
Flash forward, Carlos is now 15 years old.
Juan Becerra has come to take us to his home for the weekend so he can spend it with him and his family.
She thinks we need this, a trip to a Cuban family's house for the weekend. I know it'll be a lot like leaving the country, and I'd rather forget all about that Cuban stuff. We drive for a long, long time and end up in a town that doesn't look at all like Miami. At least, not the Miami I've come to know. It's full of lousy old cars and ugly houses, and for the first time since I've left Cuba, I'm in a town that may be full of ghosts, but it's good to eat Cuban food. I begin to feel my split personality surface intensely. I'm no longer just me, but Charles and Carlos. That house was nothing but a vortex of pain and sadness, and talk about what's been lost. But there was also lots of reminiscing and storytelling. Charles begins to feel oddly at peace with Carlos and allows him in. In a weird and unexpected way, that hard-luck family made both Charles and Carlos feel at home.
Flash forward, 10 years, a Chicago hospital room.
I'm holding my mother's hand, waiting for her to die. Earlier that day, the room had been full of Cubans, my mother's friends. But as I hold my mom's hand, I'm the only one in the room. It's nearly midnight, and everyone else has gone home. Powerful current surges from my mother's hands into mine, courses through my whole body in a flash, and fills me with hope.
I'm home.
Flash forward, 16 years later, 1,000 miles north of that sun porch in Miami.
It's Christmas Eve again, and I'm in a loft in New York. My friends were among the first to plan a living space in these old abandoned buildings. Urban pioneers. It's raining in the sheets. I can hear it directly above me. The raindrops are driving mad, the way they do in a storm, without a steady beat. The following patterns all the same, like waves. It's much too warm for Christmas. It's much too warm for snow. No white Christmas this year. No way. It's 20 degrees Fahrenheit above freezing. And tomorrow promises more of the disillusioning torrential weather. The twin towers of the World Trade Center fill all three of the window frames. They're so huge and so near. They're just a few blocks away. And even though no one is working there, they're just lit up like two colossal Christmas trees. Years later, my friend's daughter will see people jumping from them to their death. Just before the towers come tumbling down and fill the loft with the ashes of the dead and all their hopes and dreams. But tonight, on this Christmas Eve, that horror can't be foreseen. All that serves is the lousy weather and my own dismal personal failure. Crap like this is not supposed to happen. Where's the damn snow? Where's the comforting joy? Where's the cheer? Flash forward, it's the merry month of May in the year 2005. Carlos Arenal, a published and award-winning author, has just finished a talk on the Pedro Pan airlift at the public library. The place was full.
I am so sick of you people. You people are ruining this country. It's because of you people that we have Bush as a president. It's because of you people that this country is being ruined in every way and the world hates us. Why don't you people shut up, go back where you came from, and leave us alone?
Carlos takes a closer look at the old Cuban, who simply hates him for being Cuban. He notices something on his bare forearm.
Excuse me, is that a tattoo? Are you a Holocaust survivor?
So what if I'm a Holocaust survivor? What does that have to do with anything? That has nothing to do with you people and what you've done to this country. You people voted for Bush and the other one and Reagan and Nixon, and you're all stupid and always vote for the wrong side. I'm sick of all of you.
He wrestles with the devil and pinned him to the mat. If anyone should understand bigotry and its plans and the Prince of Darkness, it should be this guy.
There's nothing I can say to him.
Bigots have no way of processing any information that contradicts their way of thinking. Even bigots who've been abused by other bigots. Bastard, gavron, imbecile.
I have to forgive him.
This isn't the end of our piece.
We can't leave it here.
Why not? Inspirational story about a kid airlifted out of Cuba in the 60s. Struggles with identifying as Cuban or American, loses his mom, struggles with identity, writes a book that wins awards that some guy hates because he hates all Cubans. Seems like a totally logical conclusion to a Heritage Week piece to me.
Which color do you want?
No, we need a reconciliation, something to look forward to, some hope.
Which color do you want? This is the question that changed my life.
Cameron, stop! We need an ending that's uplifting.
This is it. I got it. It's right here.
Uh-huh. Sure.
Is this going to be as bad as your guac bit from the opener?
Take a script. Read up. But I get to be Brian Pena.
The old backup catcher for the Royals, Brian Pena?
Yep, that's him. All right, read on, my friends. Which color do you want? This is the question that changed my life. My friend held two pairs of batting gloves in his hands, one red, one green. The security guards were everywhere. I tried to act casual, but I was sweating like crazy.
It was 1999, Brian Penny was 16 years old, playing for the Cuban national team.
We had a qualifying game for the Pan American Games in Venezuela, where my friend was living at the time. I don't even want to say his name because he still has family living in Cuba.
Penny, if you want to leave Cuba, this is your chance. I'm willing to help you. I can get you to Costa Rica. You have to be willing. There's no turning back.
But if I get caught trying to defect, the consequences for me...
Yes, I know.
For my family.
I know, but we don't have much time. Tomorrow, I'm going to bring you some batting gloves. You choose which ones you want. Green means you really want to do it, and red means we forget all about it.
They couldn't speak any more about it because they were always being watched by officials that traveled with them when they went to the international tournament.
You couldn't even go to the bathroom alone. I thought about talking to my mother and father, I thought about talking to my teammates, but I didn't want to get anybody in trouble, so I said nothing to anyone. That night I didn't sleep. I stared at the ceiling and thought about what my life could be like in America as a big leaguer, but then I thought about my life in Cuba, my grandma, my grandpa, my home.
7 a.m., breakfast, hotel lobby.
Hey, Pena, which color do you want?
Green.
There was a letter waiting for him at the reception desk.
The window is open in the bathroom. Climb out, I'll be waiting for you in the car. Hey, is there any way I can go to the bathroom?
Yeah, but I have to go with you.
Okay, but I need some privacy, you know what I'm saying?
Sorry, but I'm coming with you.
Okay, but I really don't think you want to be in there for this one. Come on, where am I going to go?
Okay, you have 5 minutes. Hurry up.
The door closed behind me, the window was open. On the other side of that window could have been anything. It could be my friend, it could be security, or maybe nobody at all. It might be freedom, or it might be jail. My family didn't know where I was going, my friends didn't know, and the worst part was I didn't know if I'd see anybody again, but I didn't dream, and nothing was gonna stop that. I started weeping. I was so happy and so sad, so excited, so scared. But you know what? I was free.
To Americans, this might seem like no big deal. This kind of talk is in your blood here. But in Cuba, their window of opportunity is so small. When you talk to Cuban players who have made it to America, there's always a bit of pain behind the smiles, because they cannot see our family in Cuba. They cannot go home.
For 16 years, I haven't got to hug my family, my grandma.
Hey, I just wanted to let you know, we're talking to the Cuban government about taking a goodwill trip.
Leonor Peru, a representative from the players union.
We just need a yes or no.
Yes,
do you want to go home?
Yes, 1,000 times yes. As I got on the plane with Jose Abreu, Yasiel Puig, Alexei Ramirez, it didn't feel real. As the plane started to take off, it still didn't feel real.
Pena was sitting next to Abreu. who risked his life fleeing Cuba on a small boat and had not seen his son in almost 4 years.
He was quiet the whole flight, but suddenly I felt the wheels of the plane starting to be lowered. We all looked out the window and saw home.
On the drive from the airport to the hotel, the players saw all the places we used to hang out as kids, all the baseball fields and parks.
But none of that compared to the moment when I was able to see my family. For the first time in 16 years, I got to hug my Grandma Rosa.
This trip meant so much to people, not just to players. I wish everybody could experience the energy and the love and the passion that was running through everyone's veins.
Look, I'm not a politician, I'm just a baseball player, but I do believe that this trip was the beginning of something special. I know there's still a lot of issues to work out between the Cuban and American governments, but I think we should all try and find a way to come together. I don't know what the future holds, but I do know that the people making those decisions should think of us.
All of us.
This is our window of opportunity. Maybe it is small, but why should that stop us?